Hey guys, by the end of this video, you will know how to ensure good headroom and how to gain stage for recording, mixing and mastering. Are you ready guys? See you after the music. Hi, this is Julian Mascagna, Chief Sound Engineer at NG Studios. Welcome to Sessions with Julian, where we give you tutorials, industrial knowledge and hacks to become a better sound engineer. Let's look at what headroom and gain staging is on today's video. When I started out, I used to see all the needles going above 0 dBVU in tape recordings. I used to wonder why there is no headroom for the audio signal. And I later found out that in analog world, it doesn't matter. But in the digital world, if it goes above 0 dBFS, it can cause distortion. I was into digital world with brands like Alesis ADAT, Tascam Hi-8s, Radar Otari, Dash Recorders, and DATs, and I used to make sure there are no clips. What does that tell us? It tells us that in analog, if you go above 0 dB in view meter, your audio will be smooth. Whereas in digital, if you go above 0 dBFS, your audio will be distorted. Analog and digital have a different measurement for audio signal. In analog view meter, it is scaled to 0 VU, which is equivalent to plus 4 dBU, the maximum level for professional gears and audio consoles are plus 24 dBU, which is equivalent to your digital 0 dBFS. That's the reason to match this headroom, you need to calibrate them accordingly. Now that we are discussing analog and digital, let's discuss how to ensure you have enough headroom in your DAW. Whenever you're processing a particular track, you use plugins like EQ, compression, saturation, overdrive, etc., etc. When you use 3 to 4 plugins in a track, your audio signal gets boosted because every plugin processes in a way that increases the gain of the audio signal. If you insert an analog style plugin in a hot level track, the analog style plugin will add more harmonics with more saturation sound. If you add 3 to 4 plugins, it might cause intersample peak, which functions as distortion. Let me show you in the DAW. So guys, I'm going to show you how and level is increased in the tracks. I'm going to play this vocal track without these plugins and just observe the peaks over here. So now I am going to open one by one these plugins. As you can see, this is the equalizer. This is another equalizer for the color SSL. This is an chorus plugin. This is a saturation plugin. And this is another EQ, which is I will be going to process it. So let's start with the first plugin. Observe the peaks here. The moment I open each and every plugin, these peaks will go up. You can see this is peaking. So if I process anything, this is going to be internally distorted. Before I start mixing, I have a list of tasks to complete to ensure that the process is smooth. Do you guys have your own set of rules? If so, what are they? If you want to know more about EQ, then check out the video over here for dynamic EQ. To avoid any kind of peak, you need to reduce all the individual track clips. Level indicators for individual tracks are from minus 18 dBFS to minus 10 dBFS, which is nice and save for all the plugins to avoid any kind of peak. Same applies to recordings too. Let me tell you how to reduce clips and how to reduce it through trim plugins. So guys, I'm going to show you how to prevent any kind of intersample peak or any kind of distortion. This is the vocal track, and on the previous video I have shown by playing it that the moment you insert plugins there will be a signal boost, and let's hear it with the clip one. So if I process this, then there will be a distortion, or you can say intersample peak. So the best way is to reduce all these audio clips by -6 to 8 dB. So let's go to -8 dB and make sure all the levels are between -18 dBFS to -9 or 10 dBFS, so that you can have enough headroom for processing. So let's check the level indicators. I think that's enough for all the plugins to process. You get enough headroom and there will be no internal distortion or any kind of intersample peak. The other way to do is, if suppose your clips are 0 dB, I'll just put this vocal levels back to 0, and now you can see there will be a clip. Other option is to insert a trim plugin and reduce it to -6 or -8 dB. Let's go to -8 dB and now play the vocals. Now you can see there will be enough headroom over here. And now this trim plugin has to be copied in all tracks for the headroom adjustment. But I would suggest that you should decrease all the audio clips and then start processing your tracks. For mastering, bounce your mix track to -6 dBFS to -8 dBFS for headroom. The Lander Mastering Service and Tom Frofton from Mastering the Mix suggest to keep it around -6 dBFS. In analog processors, there are sweet spots for the inputs to sound best. For me, -6 dBFS is the right spot for the analog gears to process. If the bounce ends up being too low, then noise floor is the problem. If it is too high, then the audio will get distorted. Keeping this in mind, you have to bounce your mix between -6 dBFS to -8 dBFS. Make sure to communicate with your mastering engineer. If you are mastering in the box, then you can bounce your mix to -18 dBFS. Because most of the plugins have -18 dBFS input sensitivity. Do remember to check the plugin manual for its sensitivity level. Waves.com mention its plugin input sensitivity level on their manual. Just look at the J37, a tape emulation plugin. The input level determines the level at which the signal hits the virtual tape. Higher level result in increased harmonic distortion, saturation and compression. Its input sensitivity starts from -18 dBFS and default sensitivity is from -9 dBFS. So guys, always check for plugin manual once. If you still have doubts, then you can always check with your mastering engineer to have more analysis and suggestion. One final tip, try to mix it in 32-bit float. Why 32-bit float? Well then, because it has got a good dynamic range when you use it. I hope you enjoyed this video. See you soon. Till then, check out this video. Cheers.